Hello, everyone, and welcome. My name is Amanda, and this is one of Turnstile Tour's virtual programs. Today is actually one of my favorite types of shows because we're going to be bringing on one of our own, Brian Hoffman, to talk a little bit about the work that he does outside of Turnstile Tours. Today's show is actually focused on his current project called Around the World in One Kitchen. This is a series of short YouTube videos that he's doing with his adorable four-year-old son, Jack. I'm sorry, that's my son. his adorable four-year-old son, Sam. And they're working together to make dishes from a different country on each episode, and they're going in alphabetical order. I want to bring Brian and possibly Sam, I'm not sure if he's joining us quite yet, to give us a bit of background about the show and to tell us about what he's up to. Brian, can you hear me?
Yes. Hey, Amanda. Hi, everyone. So good to see so many familiar faces who I've met.
Hey, Sam.
Karen, and mom and dad and others. Yeah, so Sam's joining up me today, as he does every day, to chat about our newest project. Yeah. So
Brian, can you tell us just a bit about, like, tell us just a bit about what's your foodie background? As I mentioned, you know, you're a big part of our food programs. You've been with Turnstile from the beginning, is that right?
We may get, Sam is playing with the brightness right now. Who knows what's coming next? So I apologize in advance if anything goes crazy. I've been doing food blogging and food videos for a long time, over 10 years. And I've been with Turnstile from the beginning, leading the food cart tours. Volume still up? You guys can hear me?
Okay. Yeah, you're good.
I growing up, and I'm going to embarrass my parents, but they're pretty conservative eaters. So I didn't have access. I wasn't able to try a lot of international flavors and stuff growing up. My mom's laughing, but she refused to let me try sushi. When sushi became a thing, there was a Chinese-Japanese restaurant we went to, and I saw it on the menu. I was like, oh, I got to try that. My mom said, you're not trying that. I guess she was scared. And in fairness, it was the 80s before sushi in this country was as well understood, I guess, as it was then.
I feel like his parents probably knew that she didn't want to buy something that you might not eat.
Sure, of course. But then when I went to college, I discovered, you know, Thai food and Indian food and all of this international food that I was very literally foreign to me, and was really exciting. So, and then of course, moving to New York, where you can eat anything from anywhere in the world, I really have tried to. So that was a big part of my blog. And I was just so much fun in between tours, traveling like out to Bay Ridge or up to the Bronx to go discover some, this is boring, I guess. Boring talk is that going on and on. So that was always very exciting and important. And of course, on the food cart tours, telling people about international food. And, during the pandemic, obviously, that was a big shift, like not able to travel to those places and eat this food and, you know, relying on what I could cook at home, which I don't really have a chef background. I've worked in restaurants, mostly in front of the house, as a server, I know. And so this was part of that, the impetus for starting this series, was wanting to go around the world in one kitchen.
Now, before we kind of focus on the newest project, I'm just gonna take you back a little bit, because I know that this is not your first kind of foray into YouTube programming or into doing these types of short videos about food in New York. So I know you do have a couple of clips, which I was thinking maybe we can bring up some of the clips of some of your past programming.
Yeah, so the first, I should set up the very first series that I produced, you'll see it's very primitive because I mean, the quality is well before we were taking it on our phones and the phone was great. Dada, yes, bud, you wanna say something?
It's going to be the meat pie one.
Well, we're going to show them the meat pie one in a little bit, but first I'm going to show them one before you were born. So I used to have these, so my background is in theater. So I had this idea for a food series that meets like a comedy show. I would say Anthony Bourdain meets Curb Your Enthusiasm. So this gives you kind of a sense of it. This particular one is about ice cream. And we go to the Chinatown Ice Cream Factory, which we featured the owners on a previous program with Turnstile Tours. And there's another food blogger, a guy named Lawrence. One sec, Sam.
I want to go to that ice cream.
You want to go to that ice cream place? We will. Next time we go to New York, we'll have to make sure we go there. So there's another video guy. All of this, by the way, is captured on the videos that we produce. So this is all real. I just try to foil him on the ice cream escapades and try to beat him at his own game. And he was a good sport. All right, so if you want to show that.
The Seed family since 1978, it's one of the oldest and best-loved ice cream shops in the city. Visitors from all over the world stop by for their homemade frozen treats. Whether it's as unique as pandan or zen butter, as light and fruity as mango or lime sorbet, or as traditional as mint chip or pistachio, everyone has their favorite flavor.
But my favorite flavor is the almond cookie flavor. It's like pure
The almond cookie flavor is so delicious. It's so rich and creamy. It's got little pieces of cookie in there. It's fantastic.
And it goes on. That whole episode is me trying to screw up his show. And of course, my show gets screwed up. Yes, bud.
Why you took his ice cream?
Because I was not being nice. It's not nice to take people's ice cream. I was being silly. It wasn't nice.
And so actually, I have a question that involves you, Sam. Now, I can see, you know, previously you were working with older co-stars. So what do you think, like, how is it working with a co-star that's kind of occasionally prone to tantrums and outbursts? Does this make this job more difficult?
There's an old saying in theater and film and show business. Yes, buddy.
Why are you taking so long to dress up?
Why is it taking so long to dress up? Mm-hmm. Who? What do you mean? I'm Jack. Like, Jack. Oh, so in the little, Sam is very eager to see Amanda's son, who she's going to bring on later on. He's just, we're just building up. It takes you a long time to get dressed too, believe me. The question was, yeah, there's an old saying in show business, you should never work with animals or children. I've chosen to work with, it's fun. I mean, there's moments, it's, you know, parenting, you've got to have a lot of patience, and there's moments that I'm able to keep it together, and there's moments where I'm like, Sam, we have to cook this, and I'm, you know, and then I'm like, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to freak out and lose my patience, but you know, dinner is often much later than it should be, but it's great. I mean, and then watching the footage back when I'm editing, it's so funny and so sweet. And, you know, I do the editing when he's in bed, obviously. And actually not all of it. You do some of the typing, don't you? Yeah, because we have words on the screen and he helps me type the ingredients and stuff. So we do a little bit together, right?
And so other than your co-star and the technology, what have you learned from the past programs that you've kind of applied to the newest project? You had another clip of an even later program, is that right?
So this is sort of a continuation. Before the pandemic, I had this idea. I always had these ideas for web series. I've got a bunch of them. One sec, Sam. And it was called Around the World in One City. And I did three episodes where I teamed up with someone I knew from a different country. And we went to the neighborhood in New York where you could find that kind of food and learn about it. So, that was something I really wanted to continue, but before the pandemic, they can hear us. Before the pandemic, things were so busy that I had no time. Yeah, we can't hear them, but they can hear us. I hope everyone's finding this entertaining and not just like, what did I sign up for this program where a child is just running crazy? Yeah, so that was something I really wanted to turn into something bigger, and I always planned on it, but life just got in the way, and then everything kind of stopped, and I did it at home. So this is a clip from one of those episodes with Nick, who runs the Uncle Gussie's food truck in Midtown, and we are in Astoria in Titan Foods, which is a wonderful Greek grocery store. So,
and just to note, we include that is an included stop in both our financial district tour and sometimes our Midtown tour as well, when we are running the live food cart tour. So we know the Caragiorgio's quite well.
Here we have the pitas.
Now, I think pita, I think of the like the flat bread.
That's a pita bread.
Oh.
We also say pita as a pie.
Spanakopita
as a spinach pie. Coffee's like religious when it comes to Greeks.
Yeah.
Frappe, cappuccino fritos, elinico café, like a regular Greek coffee. And a cigarette. Don't forget a cigarette.
And a cigarette, of course.
So here's the section for the cheeses and stuff.
Oh my gosh.
Anything not out of Greece shouldn't be called feta.
Right.
Should not be called feta. But I think sheep's whey should be the only way to go when it comes to Greek cheese.
Yeah.
Any Greek cheese.
Yeah.
Sheep, goat, yeah.
And you know? It's soaking in salt water, is that what it is?
That's exactly what it is, it's salt water.
It's got brine almost.
Yep, and it ages in there. So when my family eats olives, these are the olives that we flow to. Kalamata olives. Listen, when you hear Kalamata olives, Kalamata is a place in Peloponneso where they strictly make olives. That's what they do.
I heard something about like children are baptized in olive oil in Greece.
Yeah, you smear them with olive. The priest has a thing and you just smear the whole baby with olive oil.
I've never been baptized.
I'll baptize you right now. Go ahead.
And so what's the distance in time between the first clip and the one that you just showed us?
Oh, that's a really good question. I've lost track of time. The first one was probably 2009, 2010. And then that one was probably about 4 years ago. So,
okay.
I don't know. What year are we in now? I have no idea. I've lost considerable amount of time. I see that the quality has gotten better. I've spent a lot more time editing it. That was actually partly filmed by Clay Williams, who is a food photographer that's been on our programs and is really really wonderful. So he helped out with that. I had like a whole crew for that last one, as opposed to like guerrilla style. They're both guerrilla style, but that one really. So in some ways I've downgraded because now it's just a setup of a camera. And at our kitchen,
the technology's come so far that the
true right you don't need as much now. Everyone could be a YouTube star, right?
We've all. And got so, were you still doing that? The Around the World in One City when the pandemic started, or have you stopped that?
Just because there was so much, I was working so much, I was giving so many tours, and I just had stuff going on. And of course, when I wasn't, I still had him. So. I had all these ideas and aspirations for continuing these series, but it just didn't have the bandwidth. And then everything stopped. And I was like, well, I'm making dinner every night. And part of it was I was getting, I was looking to more international recipes, and I came up with this idea, and I was like, well, let's do this as a thing. And I kind of thought maybe I'd have Sam involved at first, but I didn't know if he'd be into it. And so the first episode we launched, which is on Afghanistan, because we're doing them alphabetically. He's not really a part of it. He's on the end of it, but he didn't really want to like play. And then I guess he saw me doing it. And then the second time I asked him and he was all on board. And since then it's become like more or less a weekly thing that we're doing it. Right, but do you like doing the videos?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Won't push the button.
And did you do a lot of cooking with your dada before the videos, before you started the videos?
Yeah, we might. Oh, we're going to have some emojis coming up. Oh. Sam's really, grandma knows that Sam really likes emojis. She gets an emoji in the middle of the afternoon, just like textbook of emojis. Sam, did you do any cooking with dada before we started this? I don't think he did, and I don't think he really knows. I mean, this has been almost a year. I mean, we started over the summer. Not quite a year, but obviously the pandemic's been a year, and I think it's hard. It's hard for me to figure out the time. It's really hard for him. whatever is going on my screen, just I don't necessarily mean it.
That's fine.
I don't know what's going on.
We will ignore your stream of emojis.
Yeah.
So when you make the videos, I mean, as we can see, it can be difficult, especially when you add the computer into the mix. I think over the last year, anybody who has a child that's kind of dealt, a young child that's dealt with, virtual schooling or talking to grandparents or any of those things knows that this is kind of a standard feature of children on computers. So how has it been with the once you got him into the cooking, how has it been kind of with the filming? How has that gone? Have you, how many takes does it take to get this done?
He's gonna share my screen. I don't know what is gonna come up here. It sort of depends. I mean, the thing is we're cooking as we're going. Hold on, don't leave meeting. Sorry, guys. This is usually very, how do I get out of here? Oh, there it is. Okay. So we usually do like an intro, if you've seen the videos or when you see the videos, we usually do sort of an intro about the food and where we're going. And Sam and I talk about the country leading up to the day we film. So I sometimes show him clips, like we recently filmed Brazil. And so we were looking at a lot of the rainforest and animals in Brazil. And there's a lot of, like kid travel geography shows. So by the time we film, he's usually somewhat familiar with the country. And we'll usually do a few takes. I have to do a lot of takes. There was a time recently where we call it Around the World in One Kitchen, but Sam's really into numbers and he really wants it called Around the World in 10 Kitchens. Well, now he's changed his mind to 2 kitchens because we've moved.
That's fair.
He's right. We have done this in more than, we've done it in 2 kitchens. Just don't think it has the ring, but usually it starts with me doing like the intro, hi, we're from Around the World in One Kitchen, and he immediately interrupts and says, no, 10 kitchens or 2 kitchens. And I'm like, okay. And I try to get like one take. I know I wanna, you know, give myself the option of actually calling it one kitchen, which I'm, you know, for branding purposes, I think I'm sticking to.
Yeah, I think that's fair.
But the cooking, it's rare that we do more than one take. Sometimes I'll, like if he's mixing something, like I'll say, it is really guerrilla style because we'll be filming like it's wide and I'll show him and I'm like, no, don't pour it all in. And then I'll come and do like a close up of his hands. It's like, okay, pour the rest in. So that kind of thing happens. It would be interesting to be a fly in the wall, even for me to watch from outside my body, how this is working.
So do you do a lot of editing on them then?
Yeah.
There's a lot of editing.
There is a lot of editing. There's the editing. I mean, the food editing is pretty easy because I'll set a camera up above the food and then that'll just kind of tell the story of how to cook the dish. But the editing between me and him is a lot. And I think I'm actually thinking of launching something like a Patreon page, and one of the tiers might be bonus features because I've got all this extra footage that just doesn't quite work for the 7 minutes that I think I'm gonna sort of post of each episode for like, for subscribe certain level of subscribers. I've got to figure that out. Try to stop the truck. Some days, you know, some days he's really into it. And like this week he wanted to help like the whole thing. Sometimes he just wants to come say hello, talk about the country and then go back and play. And then I'll do all the cooking. So so that, you know, I don't want to force him to do these.
Why not to stop this car?
Yeah, he's really into cars. So he's making me play stop.
Ooh.
Yeah.
And so you mentioned the program 7 minutes, right? So if you roughly 1 7-minute program, how long does it take you to put that together, would you say?
So it depends. We start, you know, depending upon the dish, a lot of these countries, I'll look at their national dish first to see if that's something that makes sense for us to cook. When are we going to see Jack in a little bit? And we're also going to make something for everybody. We recently made feijoada, which is the national dish of Brazil, which is like a stew of pork and black beans, and it takes hours and hours and hours to cook. So something like that, we start filming, I think that one we started at like 12:30 or 1 o'clock. So we started, and I even did some prep the night before with soaking the beans and stuff. But you know, it sort of just depends on the dish and how long that dish is supposed to cook for. But I don't know, I mean, the intro usually takes us like, 45 minutes or so between like this kind of thing where like in the middle of explaining the dish, Sam's like, I want to play with this car. I want to like give you a raspberry, or I want to jump on your head or whatever he does, which is a lot.
And so, I mean, we might as well bring up a clip of the show so we can show everybody, you know, who's not fully familiar.
One of the things I didn't realize was going to come out of this is just the conversations he and I have as we're doing this. And it's kind of a comedy routine. I think my background in theater, it just kind of, and him being a child, I just slipped into this kind of like jokey back and forth. It's pretty funny. So here's a clip, one of my favorite little like moments from the whole series so far.
Now, onions can make you cry. There is, I'm not sure, there's some sort of chemical they release that while you're cutting them, it makes your eyes burn. Probably to protect the onion.
When I was a baby.
Yeah.
I saw cutting.
When you were a baby, you cut onions?
Yeah.
Did you tell me and Mama that you were cutting onions when you were a baby?
Yeah.
You did? I don't remember. Is that why you cried? That's why you cried when you were a baby?
Dad, your eyes might burn.
My eyes might burn too. Yeah, I'm used to it, but it doesn't make it any easier. It's one of those sacrifices we make when we cook.
And there's lots of those little moments that are just, I don't know, so much fun and unexpected. I still don't know what he meant. He was cutting onions when he was a baby. I have no recollection of that.
Honestly, Jack, every single story, everything starts with when I was little. I mean, he's 3 and a half, you know, but everything is when I was little, I did this. I had a whole collection of these.
Yep. You know, it's so interesting. You know, even before I started this series, I mean, this is true, I'm sure, of all kids this age. Like, I often wonder how much of his childhood, like this age, he's going to remember, because I don't remember that much, but it's all documented. Like, we have so many videos of him like on vacations or whatever, just day to day. So like that's all out there for him to remember as he's growing up. So I don't know if I talk. Hold on, Sam.
I can.
I don't. He wants to share the screen, but I.
No, I can do.
I know, but everyone's watching. They don't want you to push that button to close it. Sorry. Yes.
Okay. So yeah, I mean, you mentioned vacationing, and obviously at the moment, none of us are doing too much traveling, but. The whole premise of the show is that you visit a different country through making, you know, a national dish or a popular dish in that country. But, you know, I mean, there's like 195, I think, or so countries. So what's your kind of, is this going to be a long-term project? I mean, you started right at the beginning. Are you planning on going all the way?
I am. I mean, I have no idea what's going to happen as he gets older. He's really into China. So at the very, he keeps asking, when is China coming? So at the very least, we're going to make it to China, which is coming up. I don't know. We'll see. If he loses interest, I might continue to do it myself, because I'm very much like a completist. I love like checking off lists. So I'd feel really good that I've accomplished all the countries. So we'll see. I mean, that's the plan. The plan is to keep going. And, you know, speaking of vacations, like we actually, my wife, Sarah, and I are big travelers. Before this, we would take one or two big vacations every year, and we brought him along. So he's already been to Spain, Mexico, Croatia. And we had another trip planned to Sicily with him this past summer, which obviously we had to, and Oaxaca. We were going to go back to Mexico. Both had to get obviously canceled or postponed. So for us, like bringing him all over the world, you know, with the means that we have and we can, is very important to us. And this is a way of doing that. He always, it's so funny, because he always, when we talk about these countries, he's like, I want to go there. You know, we're talking about Afghanistan. I want to go to Afghanistan. I was like, I do too. I do too. One day, we'll see. So yeah, I think it's exciting him about the world and about travel and different cultures and all of that. So
it's well, that's one thing I like about the way that you mold the show. It's not just a straight up cooking show. I mean, it's obviously very focused on cooking, but there's a little bit of talking about why you're making what you're making and where it comes from. And for Sam, has there been any country or food that you've made that you've continued to talk about or want again or? We think about
of all the videos we made, what was your favorite?
Afghanistan? No.
The one you would always talk about for a long time, and when I put him to bed sometimes, he would ask me before he goes to bed, how do we make Algeria? Or he would always ask, it wasn't Algeria, it was Angola. How do we make Angola? You really like that Angolan chicken. Not anymore. You've changed your mind?
No, it's the other one.
What other one? Andorra?
No.
Austria? I know you went to Austria, right?
Yeah, and he's been into, so we made Australian meat pies, which there's a clip in a little bit.
Oh, Australia. And we didn't
eat all of them, so they were in the freezer. And so recently we defrosted one and he ate it. So I think it's fresh in his mind, the Australian meat pie. But he doesn't eat the meat. He just eats the bread. It's so weird. But
and the ketchup.
And the ketchup, right? You serve it with ketchup. It's really just a vessel for ketchup.
How about for the more grown-up palates in the house? Have there been dishes that you've liked so much you've made again, or that have become kind of a staple of your daily?
Yeah, it's so funny because I think about it, like on film I get him critiquing the food, but my wife also eats these and I do as well, but she's, you know, her, a little more discerning of a palate, and she'll try just about anything that he won't. There have been a lot of delicious dishes, and you know, I'm not a chef, so a lot of this is experiments, and when something goes wrong, it's, you know, clearly my fault rather than the dish's fault. You know, it's hard to say like, oh, I don't like that dish, because like I don't really know what I'm doing. I do a lot of research, a lot of videos, a lot of food blogs, and I often I try to find one that's in another language other than English if the country speaks another language, because I really want to try to find something as authentic as possible. I don't know, that's a weird word, authentic. I know that doesn't really mean a lot, but at least something that's made, a recipe that comes from someone from that country rather than someone like me who is, you know, I can make Angolan chicken. It's like, well, I can try.
It looks like there's a question from Cindy. Oh,
yeah.
Okay, hey guys.
Hey, Cindy.
So I have been, Andrew and I have been watching the series, Sam, and it is so good. And we love to see you tasting all these foods and giving your reviews. And one of the things I wonder about is like, do you guys choose which food you want to cook together? Like, or Brian, do you pretty much decide, like, how do you decide between, like, there's so many different dishes that you could cook from Australia, like,
yeah.
So is it because you cook something that you think Sam is gonna like, or like how does that work?
That's a really good question, and I feel bad that I haven't involved him in the decision making. Also because, you know, he's now four, and like, who knows? He said what he says he wants a few days from now, and then when we actually get cooking is gonna change. But I do think about what he might eat. Like, there's a lot of rice, which is traditional a lot of countries, but it's also one of his favorites, so I know he'll eat that. Also my wife is gluten-free, so I kind of try to find stuff. The meat pie was not gluten-free, and she just said forget it, you got to make a meat pie from Australia, which is kind of had to. So I choose it, and I choose it based on those, and also something I really try to find something that is distinct from that country, which is hard because a lot of, you know, nearby countries will make variations on the same thing. But I'm trying to think of an example. I'm planning the next one we're going to film is Bulgaria, and Bulgaria, a lot of the food in Bulgaria is very similar to the food in Greece or Turkey. So I'm looking at something called mishmash. I don't know what you did, Sam. That is like a scrambled egg dish that seems to only be from Bulgaria. So I'm kind of attracted to that idea. And I know he eats eggs, and it's a little different than the stews we've been making. All these countries, a lot of stews are pretty traditional. So there's a lot of factors. I probably should write down, like, you know, these are like my, what's the word? I want to hit all these marks, but it's just kind of floating around here. I will say a lot of times we don't film these, although it's something else I'm thinking about for Patreon options is, yeah, he loves to do this. This is the worst, is when we're trying to make videos and we're talking and he just decides to do this. And I'm like, that's very helpful. Thank you so much. What was I saying? Oh, we sometimes make cookies or desserts from that country like a few days later. So like we made Anzac biscuits from Australia, which we didn't film, but that was something that he was really, obviously really excited about. I thought if this ever goes haywire and he's just like not into it, I just pivot and start just doing cookies from every country, and that will keep him interested. for sure.
Anything where you can eat before you actually cook.
Yeah. So there's two more clips I wanted to share. One shows the cooking and how Sam really gets involved. This is the meat pie one that you really helped make. And then the other one is at the end of each episode, I've tried it. There's one or two that I missed the reaction shot of him tasting the food or not tasting the food. And then we've got a little cooking demo that we should probably, I don't want to run too long. I guess we got time. Okay, so this is one of Sam's favorites.
We got to work the butter into the flour. Drop it in. And you do it like this, see? But it's better not to go back and forth. It's better to go out and then back. Like, watch. Out, and then start over, and back. In the middle. I'm teaching him like I know what I'm talking about. Over here. Okay. Wow! Where did Sammy go? Where's Sammy?
Here!
Oh, you're right there!
Those are like nest eggs.
Oh, they are like nests.
I would call them nests. Well, these are beautiful nests.
They are beautiful nests.
Well, you know, one thing that you had mentioned before, which I think is really worth noting, is that, you know, you like you said, you're not a chef, you're not a professionally trained cook, but the show's not really an instructional show about cooking. It's a show about food and about, you know, food from other countries.
Yeah, that's totally true. I mean, I put the recipe down in the description. Don't do that. That's gross. Here we go. Yeah, I put that down in the description just because on YouTube people are looking for that stuff. But you're right. I mean, in some of the videos, I say, look, these are experiments and I hope they're inspiration for other people to try making something different. I mean, these dishes are not stuff. I mean, I used to make like roasted salmon with kale and sweet potatoes. You know, that's not anything too unique or international. So this was really as sort of expanded what we eat at home, and even outside of the program, I looked to we did a series of Thai programs through Turnstile recently, and that also helped inspire me to make dishes I was maybe familiar with eating, but certainly not familiar with cooking, and shopping. This is kind of a tangent, but shopping for some of these ingredients is part of the like fun of it. Like leading up to it, I'll put together all the ingredients I need. I'm like, oh, where am I gonna get Vegemite, or where am I going to get shrimp paste, you know? And so I'll try to find markets nearby, or sometimes I'll look online, and it's super fun putting it all together. Sam's pushing so many buttons, so my Zoom.
Well, do you want to show the last clip, and then we'll
and you
bring
know
my little guy on for
demo? You know how tough it is to, you know, get them to taste new things, and even
well, that was one other thing I really wanted to ask you was, do you have any tips or about tricks? How do you get him to taste stuff or even cook with you for so long?
Yeah, well, the cooking is really, I think it's an activity. It's a fun, different activity to do together. So I think he just naturally wants to be a part of it. And he loves like setting up the camera and pushing the button with the light, excuse me, and all the, you know, the gadgets that go with it as well. In terms of tasting things, for the videos, it's as we've posted more of these, he knows that he rates them and gives them a number. And so that's really fun for him.
Can you get it back?
Get it back to gallery view. This is good practice.
Well, it looks like Matthew's got a question, and then we can go ahead and share the video. Matthew, do you want to turn on your sound?
Hello, can you guys hear me?
Yes, welcome. Thank you.
Hey, Brian, how's it going?
Good to see you.
Good to see you too. I've been loving the videos. I think they're amazing and they're hilarious. You mentioned sourcing the ingredients. I was curious about that. I'm also, I guess my question is, you obviously have to get a lot of relatively uncommon ingredients for a lot of these dishes. What do you do with all the extra ingredient that you have after you make a dish?
Yeah. You know, it's funny because during the beginning, like when the pandemic started, we were really good about using what we had. And I still am trying to do that as I kind of plan the dinners, even outside of the videos throughout the week. I look what we have, but I have like a bunch of like dried limes, for example, that stay good for a long time. So that's good, that are just in my cabinet. I store them. I mean, if something's perishable, I'll try to find other things to cook with that, outside of the videos for dinners and stuff. But I do have more black limes and corn flour and stuff that I wouldn't have before that's here. You're right. It's part of the fun, but it is acquiring a lot of stuff. I feel like we're like a professional restaurant kitchen a little bit, at least in terms of what we have. was there another question about that as well? No, that was
it mainly. I was curious where you got them,
it depends on the cuisine, you know? I mean, Asian cuisines are a little bit more easier because there's quite a bit of Asian markets nearby. So for Bulgaria that we're gonna be filming hopefully next week, I really wanna get this special cheese. I think it's pronounced serene. It's Bulgarian feta that I've not fully gone down the rabbit hole to find out where to get it. Hopefully there's a market that specializes in, I guess, Eastern European specialties. So it just depends on the food. And there've been one or two things that I just couldn't get, and either I find a substitute or I choose a different dish. That's another part of it. Like we made Brunei recently, and their national dish is this crazy sounding thing that I'm dying to try called ambuyat, which is made with sago starch. And it's like this sort of gooey sort of thing. You use this special kind of chopsticks that's like two prongs, and you pick up this like gooey, I can't even explain it. Look up ambuyat from Brunei, and then you dip it into sauces and you eat it. So it's like a vessel for dipping. But it just sounded so complicated in getting everything, and I didn't think he would like it or my wife would like it, so I looked for something else. Andrew asked, what's the farthest you've had to travel for ingredients? And Bulgarian cheeses. Oh, and the Russian store is in Brighton Beach. Oh, thanks, Matthew. Yeah, right? I bet that's Jack's there too now. What's the farthest I've traveled? I don't know. I think I've driven about a half hour. I mean, we live in New Jersey. And we have a car, which is a little bit easier to get around. I've driven like a half hour, which isn't that far. But I mean, I would love if, I don't know, I don't quite feel comfortable going into the city and riding out to Brighton Beach, maybe driving out there for the Bulgarian cheese. Like that would be something I do pre-pandemic, no problem. But you know, that's helped, that's made it a little harder. So
I just wanna make sure we have time for the demo. Should we play that last video?
Sam's muted all of you guys. Okay. Yes, hi Amanda.
Hey, should we play that last video and then you guys can give us a cooking demo?
Last video and then we'll do a quick cooking demo for sure.
Everyone, this is Jack. Yeah. He's come for the final tasting.
Yeah. Try a piece of potato, see what you think. Just a small piece. Okay, try. That's a little tiny piece of rice. Use your fork. Do you want me to cut it or you want to just eat it with your hands? Whoa, see all that steam?
But I don't want them eating.
I knew that was coming. Eat this part without the beef on it. Here, the beef is off. Just eat this.
No mango.
Mango? You mean peach? No. There's no peach on that.
Try it, buddy. You want it on a different plate?
I'm not hungry.
Okay.
Yum. Is that good chicken? That's the palm oil chicken. That's the Moamba de Galinha. How many stars do you give it?
I will give it
10. 10 stars.
So we do have success every once in a while, but it's a little bit of a battle. Sometimes, but
I mean, 10 stars is a pretty good review.
They've gotten even higher. You'll see coming up next season. So we've gone through all the A's. So we posted all the A's, and we have that I've yet to edit, or there's a few edited. So we're taking a few week break before we post the next one. We'll see as it progresses. The stars get higher and higher. I'm starting to give things 1,000 stars, which is great to hear. It speaks to my cooking, maybe.
Well, you know, we just said we've got about 15 minutes left, but do you want to give us that, give us the demo?
Yeah, let's go over into the dining room.
Well, while Brian is taking a moment to set up his camera in the kitchen, I, as they say on TV, I have another, an already made Johnny cake right here. It's not really up to snuff in terms of the quality that I think Brian is going to produce. As I mentioned, Brian is in fact the resident foodie and not myself. Yeah. So it's a pretty novice effort to say the least. But I think Jack's going to be a good sport and see if he can put on some Sam shoes and do a little bit of trying for us. Brian will give you a bit more information about this, but this is a Johnny cake in the bohemian sense. Johnny cake is one of those terms that's used for lots of different types of food from what I've learned over the last couple of days. But this is my own version of the Johnny cake. Jack, do you think you could take a little bite for me? Not hungry? Just a little taste?
Okay.
All right, let's see.
We made some Johnny cake last night too, that Sam could taste and give his review.
Sam's tasting it too.
One star.
One star. Oh no.
One star.
1,000 stars.
One. Jack, yeah. What? Sam's dad, I got 1,000 stars. I got one. That's probably pretty accurate. Brian, I'm going to leave it to you to
listen, like I said, we're still learning. Oh, he wants more. Well, that's a good sign. The next video we're going to post in a few weeks is the Bahamas, which is also the first international country that we've gone through. Well, no, first international country at all that I've been to as a kid. I grew up in South Florida, so the Bahamas was pretty accessible. So that was kind of exciting. Although, to be fair, I don't really remember eating very authentic Bahamian food, which I probably didn't when I was a kid. But we made, on the video that comes out in a few weeks, we made chicken salves, which is the soup. Yeah, bud. How many stars will I give it? I'll give it four or five stars. Yeah, it's buttery. It's pretty good. Yeah, and we also made cracked conch on that episode, which is super exciting. But Johnny cake is something that's supposed to be served either for breakfast or alongside a soup or a stew. So it would have made sense for us to make it on that day, but there was just so much going on and we didn't. So we figured we'd make it today. Johnny cake, anyone from New England has probably heard about Johnny cake. This is a little different. Johnny cake in New England is like a cornbread. It's made with cornmeal. This is just butter, flour, sugar, salt, baking powder, and milk. The story, you want more? Sure. The name may come from journey cake because it probably was brought from British nationalists who, after the Revolutionary War, fled and went down to places like the Bahamas and brought it with their slaves, and the enslaved people would prepare it up in New England and then ultimately down in the Bahamas as well. So maybe that's the story behind it. It sounds like it's people are unsure of exactly the history of it. See, some of this history stuff, like I learn about it and I'll write on my blog and maybe I'll put little blurbs on the video, but it's hard to like get this out in a fun way. And just usually this back and forth is just so much fun that I cut that kind of stuff out of the videos. But so Sam, do you want to mix this? And we're going to make more of this. So if you enjoyed this, we're going to have even double that. So for the Johnny cake, we've got flour. I think it's 3 cups of flour. We've got 1/4 cup of sugar. You want to pour it all in? And you know what? I've got another on my phone. That's right. I can. Is this going to work? Show, you don't want to see me, you want to see him. Huh. You, they want to see you. All right, so mix all of the dry stuff, Sam. So you mix that here. This is flour. Okay. He loves mixing and peeling onions. That's another thing. One of my tricks. It wasn't a trick at first. It just turned out to be a trick. When I have onions in the recipe, I'll put out onions on the table as we talk, and he loves peeling the onions. And I'm able to get like all of my jokes and my intro out while he peels onions. It's crazy. No, not the milk yet. Next we wanna do, we've never done any of these live. So this is fun. Salt, baking powder. Oh, try to get it all in. And we're not normally eating as we cook here either, but and now we wanna mix it all together. Okay. Has anyone, I'm not able to see the chat very easily. Oh, I could see it here maybe. Has anyone had Johnny Cake in the Bahamas or in New England or anywhere else in the Caribbean? Yeah, mix it all really good.
Yeah.
Did you like the bread, Jack, at all?
What do you think? Did you like the bread at all?
Yeah. But I do, but I don't make frozen. I don't make it frozen.
Did you like the bread, baby?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. He liked it. So, I don't know, though. It was pretty bad, Brian. I think he's just being nice. It was terrible.
Yeah, do you want to add in the butter now?
I'm going to make it frozen.
Now, normally I try to have him wash his hands and not eat while we're doing this, but since none of you are eating this food, I'm not as worried about him washing his hands, but you should wash your hands if you're cooking. Okay, and now we got to mix this with our hands, but you're eating. See, this is, we didn't plan, I'm going to stop this video, I think. There is the oven finally preheating. I think I mentioned I do a lot of research. There's a lot of YouTube videos out there of people cooking. I don't think I realized YouTube is like a huge search engine. I guess I just sort of did it, but as I'm doing research about how to like promote YouTube videos, I don't know if any of you, like when you're like, it makes sense. When I like need to figure out how to change a light bulb for, that's a really bad example because I know how to change a light bulb, but how to, I don't know, figure out Zoom, you know, you go to YouTube and there's all these tutorials. So, you know, when I look
up- One thing, I mean-
Yeah.
I was just going to say one thing I've enjoyed using YouTube for that I'd never used it for before is watching kind of short travel videos to places. Obviously, I'm not able to travel at the moment, but just little clips of things. And yours is kind of similar to that, even though, you know, you're not physically going anywhere. It's reminiscent of those.
Totally. Yeah. And we, like I said, we watched some of those before. There's wonderful ones with kids in Bhutan. What's that?
I got you this hand.
You can use that hand? Okay. We want to cut the butter into it so it becomes kind of like crumbs. Yeah. Yeah. It's YouTube's great. I found I've started following some of these like video blogs of like this particular recipe I found from a woman named Melda 242, I think is her name on YouTube. And she's from the Bahamas and she makes Bahamian dishes. And there's all sorts of people specializing in specific cuisines. It's super exciting. Okay, so do you want to add in the, you're washing your hands? Good job. He knows to wash his hands. He's going to wash his hands. And then we're going to add in the milk. We're going to turn it into a dough and then hopefully we will roll it out well. So yeah, we did move in the middle of this pandemic and strangely enough, we moved from Jersey City to the suburbs, and we have a smaller kitchen now than we did before. So we've had to sort of adjust a little bit to the videos. We were so lucky. Our old apartment, we had like a studio kitchen, like a TV studio, as if you see in those videos, it was perfect. So we had to adjust a little bit. This dining room has kind of worked, and then we move over to the kitchen for some of the videos. We may change things around a little bit in the kitchen. Do we want to mix this up? Now you want to add the milk?
So I know the Bahamas are coming up, but where are you in terms of the countries? How many have you filmed?
So
what do you have planned? Where are you going from here?
We filmed our 25th video, which was Brunei. I think we've only posted 11. So I just know how long it takes me to edit from my previous experience with YouTube. So that's something I learned. Before I started posting these, I wanted to film and edit a lot. And so I did that. I had 11 pretty much ready to go. And then all of a sudden I'm like, oh yeah, I better catch up. So I've got two more edited, and then I'm gonna, and you know, as I edit and I learn the sort of structure I've created for myself, it gets easier to edit them as I go. So I'm thinking in like 2 or 3 weeks, I'm gonna start posting the B's. We go by letter. We've gone through all the A's and now we're on the B's. So it's Bahamas. Do you remember them all? Bahamas, Bahrain.
That's the one that I thought.
You love Bahrain. He loves talking about Bahrain, which we were pronouncing Bahrain for a little while. We learned that's not, there's no A in the middle.
Bahrain.
He still says Bahrain. Barbados, Bangladesh, which is exciting.
Bahrain.
Yeah, where Bosnia jumped up, Belize. We've done Brazil. We've done a lot.
Matthew wants to know if you did Belarus.
We did do Belarus, of course. Do you remember Belarus? I don't know if you remember
everyone,
that.
Matthew, everyone. We're hitting every stop.
Every stop, what did he say? Every country.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. You're hitting everyone, right? You're not leaving any out.
Yeah, we did Belgium. I did not make a Belgian waffle. I bought one for Sam to enjoy after our meal. We made, what did we make from Belgium? Oh, moufrites, which was something different. And Belarus, we did like a potato pancake. I forget the official name of it, but it was a potato pancake and some sort of sausage. I don't know. That's one that I haven't edited yet, and it's been a while since we filmed it, so I'm trying to like remember the details of it. Are we having fun making these videos, Sam? Yeah.
Well, it's been really fun talking to you about making the videos. We just have a couple minutes left. Does anybody else have a question or a comment, anything that they'd like to say, feel free to raise your hand. I just had one more thing. So what are you planning on doing with the Johnny cakes then that you've made now? What are you just going to eat them straight up? How are you planning on eating them?
Oh yeah, so we didn't do this because I was trying to set everything up, but I think in the mornings you eat it with butter and jam as a breakfast. He may eat this whole portion from last night before we all say goodbye. We're gonna eat them. I don't know what we're doing for dinner tonight yet, if it makes sense to go along with it. But yeah, I mean, the Johnny cake is, from what I understand, is breakfast and as like a, you know, it's like cornbread, you know? You could eat it with jam and butter in the morning, or you could eat it with barbecue. So it's that kind of thing. So we'll see, but it's not gonna go to waste. I mean, if he's really not eating this batch, I guess I'll freeze some. That's the other thing is, you asked if we've repeated any of these. We haven't needed to really, because at least early on, I was making huge portions. Like we had a giant pot of Andorran escudero, which is this like very hearty smoky soup. I think we finished it all now, but we have a bunch in the freezer.
Where's Jack?
Where's Jack, Amanda?
Oh, Jack had to go. Hey, Jack. I'm not sure if he'll come back.
Been exciting for me because, like, for instance, Andorra is a country I did not know existed. Do you know where Andorra is, Amanda?
I do not. I don't know anything about Andorra.
Neither. It's like it's in between Spain and France. It's this tiny little country in the Pyrenees that I had no idea. But it's there alphabetically.
No, we both know. Well, again, Brian, thank you so much. If nobody has any questions or anything they want to say, I'm going to let you go and get that dough into the oven.
This for about 25 minutes. We're going to put it in this. I'm going to take the other one out of this pan and put it in at 350. And that's the recipe I found. If anyone wants to try this themselves. Yeah, but any other questions or? He's spelling it out, I think.
Oh, it looks like Matt's got one last question. And Kenneth wants to know, let me see, pull up, are you working from a list of countries?
Yeah, I don't remember. I Googled list of countries in the world. And there's another, I've often consulted, I'm not the first person to do this by any means. There's a woman, I forget her, Sasha, I think's her name, globaltableadventure.com. And she has a map room that I consult. And so I look to see what other people have done and get ideas from them as well. But then I go towards, you know, the international blogs, the people from those countries that are posting their recipes. So yeah, I do have a list of countries. And one thing I've missed is they're not recognized, I guess, by the UN, but there's like territories and stuff. Like Anguilla is one that I did not do. So I thought if this is successful, maybe I'll go back and do as many of those as possible. Also thought maybe of going back and doing different like regions of countries. Like when we get to China, I don't even know like how to choose one dish from China that is representative of the country. So I might make it like a series, like 3 or 4 episodes of China, or I might go back. I haven't decided yet. Same with the US, right? When we get, he's gonna be like in his 20s when we get to the United States alphabetically, but yeah, we might divide it into states and do a dish from each state. I don't know. So I've got a list of countries, but I feel like that's a little, there's obviously more to the world than that. Yeah. Did Matt have a question?
Yeah, so we know some of Sam's favorites. I was wondering if you had any favorites or if there's anything that you've done that you're going to be adding to your family's regular rotation.
Yeah, I think we all really loved the escudella soup from Andorra, which was really complicated. It had like every meat possible. Sam had a ham hock in it, which he loved. So it was really smoky and hearty. As the weather gets warmer, we won't be making that for a while, but we really loved that. Sometimes I impress myself, like when I made cracked conch, I was like, oh no, that was an ingredient that I had a real hard time finding even in Manhattan, or lower Manhattan, which I had easier access to. Thanks, bud. Excuse me. You could find scungili and canned conch, but that wasn't what I wanted. And I found a Latin American market, in West New York, New Jersey, that had conch from Honduras. That was the real deal. So I was really impressed with when I did that. Not making it again, because I think I was the only one that was into it. There's something coming up from Bahrain that was a stewed chicken with rice and the dried limes that was really tasty. And part of it is I've got a lot of dried limes still to use. And that was a double purchase. I think I got them and then my wife got them because she saw them. So we have like double the amount of dried limes.
Right.
Good ingredient because it stays good for a long time. Right. Yeah. So a lot of them. And sometimes I just get inspired by the country and I'm like, oh yeah, I read about that dish that I decided not to make. We should do that tonight. And so sometimes that has happened. Yeah.
Awesome.
Yeah. Well, thanks everyone. Unless there's any other questions, I don't know. I know we're at 12 o'clock. I didn't mean to go late. I realized that I have to re-grease this or put down some parchment paper. I've got parchment paper here. Yeah.
Well, thank you, Brian. Thank you for telling us all about your show and what you've been doing and introducing us to Sam.
Yeah, and thank you all so much. If you're not familiar with the videos, I think there's one more slide. I put up my blog where you can sign up for a newsletter. I've been sending newsletters out once a week with updates, although I probably won't send them out till the next video comes. And you could subscribe on YouTube. If you're on YouTube, subscriptions, you know, subscribing is super helpful. I think I'm going to launch a Patreon page. So I'll put that in the newsletter if you guys want to be a part of that. That's super helpful as well. Thanks so much. And thank you, Cindy, Andrew, and Amanda for featuring us, this little project that we decided to launch and having fun with. Thanks.
Bye.
Want to say bye? Say bye to everyone.
Bye.
Bye.
Bye. Good point out there. Say bye.